scouring the country. Where did they get that? Oh, they must have gone to Germany or something.
I will do a voiceover, which will get us here. Mm-hmm. So I'm going to say, Don, welcome to RTV Atlanta.
Thank you. My pleasure to be here.
Good.
So, we're rolling.
Don George, welcome to RTV Atlanta.
Thanks. It's my pleasure to be here.
You've been president of the Georgia affiliate of the ACLU for now almost 2 years.
About a year and a half, almost two.
We want to talk about several things today, but first of all, let's talk about this Making Schools Safe program. How did that one come about? And you're kind of unique with this one because you're one of just three states that are doing this.
Just three states. It was a program developed in Northern California about 3 or 4 years ago. Became highly successful. They're doing a couple of these a month in their schools. And it was so effective that the national ACLU came in and said, wow, this would be great to do elsewhere. And when I heard that, I lobbied heavily, and they chose Georgia as one of the three states because of our demographics, as well as the ACLU has about 25% of the board members are gay or lesbian, and we have a large membership that's gay and lesbian.
So how does the program work?
Basically, we are going into the schools, hopefully at their invitation, and giving them an in-service training exam, telling them that it's their legal liability to make sure every single student, including gay and lesbian students, are safe. They have a safe learning environment, that there's no harassment, no violence, no just nothing that would endanger the gay and lesbian students. And if they allow it to proceed, not only is the school district liable, but each administrator and teachers who did nothing are personally liable. So that's a very powerful message.
So some of the other programs we're seeing that were addressed to the students, this one is toward the administrators.
Sorry.
What's the matter? Don, the question I have in mind is that there are other programs that are addressed to the students, but this one is particularly focused at the faculty and the administration.
Exactly. It's complementary because we're talking to administrators and other groups are talking to students, and there are probably 150 to 200 school districts in Georgia, so there's more than enough work for any organization who's interested to get in there and do what they can do. Certainly, it's very important that our gay and lesbian youth be safe in the schools.
So why did the ACLU get involved in this when there are other gay groups involved in the schools already?
We're approaching it from a legal point of view, and the ACLU basically argues law and protects people's rights.
And are you seeing more cases coming forward, and that's the reason people need some advice on this, particularly teachers who are sort of caught cold with legal advice some days of the week?
Yeah. There are teachers that call us, and there are incidents that happen in their school, yet they don't want to get involved. One of their biggest fears is that they themselves would be called gay or lesbian, and in some instances they are, but in most instances they're not. They're just progressive people that want to see the right thing done. So if we could go into that school system and give a blanket in-service training, that would help solve the situation without actually pinpointing that teacher.
Now, I know you don't want to talk about particular schools or systems in the area, but how are you approaching, how do they know about this program now?
We have not actually started it yet. We have brochures that are going to be mailed to the various teachers. We have teachers unions that are willing to cooperate. We have teachers unions in other rural districts that want to see the program, evaluate it, and then possibly go back to their small town school principal and say, hey, I saw a really good program. I think we need it in our schools. There's the safety angle. Basically, keeping schools safe is a safety issue. And there's certain provisions in the Georgia statute that provide for in-service trainings on safety.
And you also are having both a lawyer, then there's a teacher, and there's also maybe a former student involved in this?
A student and or his parent.
I see.
Actually, he's the most powerful segment of the presentation because one of the big things principals or administrators tell us is, oh yeah, well that may be a problem in the Atlanta schools where you have those kind of people, but we don't have it here. So if an actual student from that district comes forward and says, yeah, I'm gay, this is what happened when I was in that school, or this is what's happening now, that's a very powerful message and it gets their attention. And in fact, we have a couple of students that have stories like that. One close to Atlanta and one significantly further from Atlanta. And those may be our two opening schools.
Hmm. So this pilot program begins in January. How long will it run then?
We have a two-year commitment with a possible extension. The budget for 2 years is $95,000, and we're a little over a third of the way there now, I'm proud to say. So if anybody's interested in this program or you think that keeping kids safe, our gay and lesbian youth safe in schools, I would encourage you to please contribute to this program.
So
it's going to be a good one.
Call the Georgia affiliate of the ACLU?
You can call at 404-523-6201, or you can send a check and designate it for Making School Safe Project, or MSS, to the ACLU of Georgia, 142 Mitchell Street, Suite 301, Atlanta, Georgia, 30303.
As you're saying that, we're supering this. Everybody can take a note from their pad and put it down.
Great.
Well, thanks, John. This is a great program. And I just want to emphasize again, it's in conjunction with the GLSEN and the PFLAG programs.
PFLAG and GLSEN are our coalition partners, and we went to them early on and presented the program, and they were both enthusiastic supporters.
Well, we'll be back.
In fact, PFLAG is helping us with some of the students and teachers, as is GLSEN.
We'll be back in a few months, and you can tell us how it's going.
Yeah, and I hope you interview Beth, too, because she'll probably have some first-hand stories to tell.
Yeah, she is the coordinator.
Beth Luttrell.
And she's now graduating from Georgia State.
She's in her final year at Georgia State Law School.
So she'll pick it up in January.
Yes, and she's a brilliant, up-and-coming lesbian attorney. I see good things in her future.
Good. Thanks, Don. Don George, we're glad to see you again, and we want to talk today about the broader aspects of the American Civil Liberties Union and pretty much how they've gotten involved in the gay issues facing society today, particularly when we've already got the Lambda Legal and Educational Defense Fund, we've got the Servicemen's Defense Fund. Why is ACLU now involved in this?
Well, ACLU was started in 1920, and its primary purpose was to defend the rights of citizens in the Constitution and the Bill of Rights. It's amazing that prior to that date, no one ever thought of arguing the Bill of Rights in front of a court to enforce freedom of speech and religion and the various things. And it was only in the 1930s that the courts first threw out a law that restricted free speech, some of the sedition laws. The ACLU has been involved in gay and lesbian issues for 60 years because we considered it a right. The first case was in 1940, and it defended a gay-based play that was censored, I believe, in New York City.
Hmm.
So that's interesting.
Interesting.
We cover a whole range of rights. I mean, anything in the Constitution or Bill of Rights. So we have women's issues, we have privacy issues, we have freedom of speech issues, we have the traditional civil rights, and gay and lesbian rights are just an extension of that. It's probably the last battle or one of the last battles for rights in this country. Adding the transgender issue, we encompass all of that as part of our gay and lesbian rights. So it's really nothing new. Because we have such a broad umbrella of protecting rights, sometimes something that happens outside of the immediate gay and lesbian area is the first signal that somebody is moving against the gay and lesbian citizens. So, I'm proud to be part of the ACLU, which protects everybody's rights, because if you let the thing out here go, it's like that German poem, like when they came for the unionists, I did nothing because it wasn't me. Then they came for someone else, I did nothing. Mm-hmm. And they get closer and closer, and finally they come to you, and there's nobody left to stand up for you. So we try to stand up for everybody's rights and draw a bigger defense wall around gay and lesbian rights that way.
So if a gay man or a lesbian was looking for representation of some kind, would they come necessarily to you, or what about Lambda or the service members groups? How does that happen?
The person basically chooses based on their level of knowledge about what these groups do. So a lot of times, most of the time, we get cases just because people come to us.
you're well known.
Yeah, Lambda gets cases because people go to Lambda. And the good point here is that we all work together. Lambda was the chief attorney on the James Dale Boy Scout case that was decided by the Supreme Court this past spring, but the ACLU composed an amicus brief, worked with Lambda. Lambda was the primary group, but lots of other groups came together, and the ACLU put together a coalition, the biggest civil rights coalition in history, to support a Supreme Court case, and that was the ACLU rounding up other civil rights organizations supporting James Dale's position. Yeah. So we work together. We're not competing.
You mentioned the Boy Scouts. We just learned that you're sort of going after the Fulton County system on allowing Boy Scouts the use of the schools. Is that an issue now for the ACLU locally, or what?
It was an attempt to begin discussion on what role the Boy Scouts should have in the Fulton County schools. As the ACLU, we believe in an open forum. You know, really nobody should be excluded. But the way this case came about was a father and son came to us last spring. The son had been thrown out of a scout troop in one of the Fulton County schools because he refused to say the word God in the oath. His particular family's faith did not permit verbalizing the word God. So the scouts threw him out. They came to us saying, get us back in, do something. Well, the courts have ruled that the Boy Scouts are allowed to do that on religion as well as sexual orientation now. Well, they said then, well, then the Boy Scouts shouldn't be meeting in the schools if my son can't be a member of that troop. And so we looked at the Fulton County rules and regulations and their own rules and regulations to protect the students. I mean, they have an obligation, since these are all minors, to do something to possibly protect the students while they're under their roof and in their care, even though the troop meets immediately after school. They had a policy that said no organization can use the school building if they do anything illegal. And then a little further down they said, nor can anybody use the schools that excludes anyone from membership on the basis of race, religion, national origin, gender, or disability. So they did not say sexual orientation, but we had a guy here that was thrown out because of religion. So we simply wrote a letter to the Fulton County School Board saying, look, you have the Boy Scouts that legally can discriminate, but they are excluding members on the basis of gender, girls can't be in there, religion, and even sexual orientation, even though the policy doesn't do that. You've got a problem here. Your policy says one thing, you did something else. Please reevaluate your policy. Maybe the scouts don't belong there. Maybe your policy needs to change, but you've got a problem. So we stirred the pot trying to get a discussion going. From what I read in the Southern Voice article, the school board responded saying, well, anybody can meet here. So they basically verbalized that their policy doesn't mean anything. So the next question is, are they giving the scouts special treatment now by neglecting that rule, or do they truly mean that it's an open forum? And we will not find that out until another organization that legally discriminates but is even more despicable than the scouts comes, such as the KKK or the Aryan Nation. Then if they do not allow these people in, then the scouts are getting special treatment. If they allow these people in, then they truly mean it. It's an open forum. Anybody can
go. What about a gay group going to the school and using their facilities?
A gay group can go, and it would be an interesting question if it's a gay group that does not allow straight members. That would be the inverse of what the Boy Scout situation is. So this is the first chapter. I think we've gotten the discussion going, brought the awareness up that this is going on in the Fulton County schools, and it's up to other groups to come in and do their role, too.
Good. Thanks, Don.
Welcome. Was that too long?
Don George, tell us about yourself as a community gay leader and as a member of the ACLU. Who is Don George?
That's a difficult question. I think I'm an actively gay person that is trying to make the world a little bit better for other gay people that come around me. I was a youth who at age 7 or 8 knew I was gay, just denied it, didn't dare voice it to anybody, typically thought I was the only person in the world who was gay. I excelled in school. I went on to MIT, got an engineering degree, a master's in electrical engineering, then went to med school, specializing in medical electronics, and was involved in the building of one of the first mechanical hearts, and then a cardiac assist device after that. I was still closeted through medical school, through practice. I eventually exploded or imploded because of the secret that I was keeping, and started a self-destructive lifestyle that I'm not proud of, but ended up getting me help and addressing the issues that was really driving me crazy and helping destroy myself. That was at age 40 when I got my life back in order and realized who I really was. I realized then what I really needed to do to make sure that kids behind me didn't have to go through the same terrible journey that I did. So I became a street activist. I helped organize the Clinton-Gore Gay Legions in 1992, and he took the state that year. I worked my way into other gay organizations and got into the leadership of the Georgia Association of Physicians for Human Rights. I was president of that. I worked actively with the Human Rights Campaign and got on their board of governors, helped with Olympics out of Cobb. I helped with the Cobb Citizens Coalition. And then I thought that the next role for me would be to be an openly gay man in a more or less bigger community umbrella organization such as the ACLU. So I got on the ACLU, worked my way into the board, and then now I'm president. And it's one of the best things I've done in my life. I really enjoy it, and I think the ACLU is doing good work. Interestingly, the way I got into the ACLU was twofold. I became a member in 1988 when George Bush Sr. accused Michael Dukakis of being a card-carrying member of the ACLU. I said, wow, that group must be good. So I went up and joined. And then in the early 90s, I can't remember if it was 90 or 91, during the Cracker Barrel Wars, which I was part of, I got arrested along with seven other people at the intersection of Lenox Road and Buford Highway for holding signs that said don't eat at Cracker Barrel and collecting money for the Cracker Barrel Defense Fund. And we were really manhandled by the Atlanta police, spent the night in jail, and it was the ACLU that bailed us out the next day, took the case, and we won the case. And that was the turning point when I said this is a very worthwhile organization and I want to be more active in it. So I was.
Asked me how I knew my true love was true. I, of course, replied, something here inside cannot be denied. Said someday you'll find all who love are blind. When your heart's on fire, you must realize smoke gets in your eyes. So I chaffed them and I gaily laughed to think they could doubt my love. Yet today my love has flown away. I am without my love. Now laughing friends deride tears I cannot hide. Smile and say, when a lovely flame dies, smoke gets in your eyes. So I chaffed them and I gaily laughed to think they could doubt my love. Yet today my love has flown away. I am without my love. Now laughing friends deride tears I cannot hide. So I smile and say, when a lovely flame dies, smoke gets in your eyes. song about the evening. I feel so blue, and though my heart is grieving, I'll wait for you. I'm writing you a letter, signed love so true. Although I'm sad and lonely, I'll wait for you. When the moon was high and the lights were low, that's the time when you and I said our love would grow. If you ever get the notion, you miss me too, make it in a hurry, I'll wait for you. I'll give you all my loving, both day and night. When the moon is high and the lights are low, that's the time when you and I know our love will grow. If you ever get the notion, you miss me too, just make it in a hurry.